If John's here, it's 69 noon. Good morning and welcome to the Berks County Board of Commissioners meeting for May the 11th. We'll begin with a moment of silence followed by a pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I want to note that yesterday we had an executive session dealing with personnel, hiring and performance. Litigation, in part dealing with BCRC appeal to BHA, and litigation involving right to know appeals with MHDD and Children and Youth Services. Are there any additions or corrections for the May 4th, 2017 Commissioner meeting minutes? Hearing none, the minutes will stand approved as presented. Is there any public comment on specific agenda items? Hearing none, we'll move into the agenda. Number one, authorizing under that budget. We have two items, adopt a resolution authorizing 2016 appropriations in the amount of $37,582. 2017 budget transfers in the amount of $9,303 and 2017 appropriations in the amount of $75,285 per listing dated May the 8th of 17. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing the chair to execute the 17-18 renewal quotation to P Corp. This is the Pennsylvania County's risk pool, a program of the County Commissioners Association of Pennsylvania. We have Mike Malinowski here from EHD. Would you like to briefly address that? And EHD is the insurance company that works with our county to make sure we have the best and most cost-efficient insurance coverage for all of our needs.
Thank you, Commissioner. Just to give you a brief update, I met with Bob Patrizio for a few hours on Monday to review the quotation. We got it Friday in order to prepare it for your approval. As you know, we've been with the P Corp program from 2013 to 2014. The program's been extremely successful, not only for us, but for many counties across Pennsylvania. We're one of the largest counties in the pool, which we've worked very well with the County Commissioners Organization in improving the coverage document. This year, there's no real changes to the coverage document. There's some clarifications to coverage. I won't bore you with the three pages of what those are. Mr. Petruzio was updated on all of them on Monday, as well aware of them. Our premium, it's up a little bit over expiring. We still have that multi-million dollar hail loss claim that impacts us a little bit, but not too much. From a premium perspective, our exposures are up from a payroll perspective, and our values for our properties up. One advantage of the P Corp program is they do an appraisal every year, which saves the county probably anywhere from $50,000 to $75,000 for a full-blown appraisal. But the premiums coming in at $1,070,378. Just to give you a little comparison, before we went into P Corp in 2012, the total cost for everything included, with probably not as broad of coverage, was $1.2 million. With a property value of about $310 million. Our values right now are about $525 million. So a substantial upgrade in our coverages, along with some extra limits on certain things. Also, just to let the board aware, they have increased the grant program from $15,000 to $20,000. So EHD works with Ron's group and the safety committee in order to apply for that grant each year. Many counties are using it for numerous things related to risk management. A lot of popular things right now are cameras, of quite honestly. We see a lot of counties using it for that. We also get the 5% risk managers credit. CCAP looks at us and your contract with EH&D as having a full-time risk manager, which is a bit unique, so we're very happy we get that 5%. And we also get a 4% discount because we do meet all of their loss control credits. So we're getting the maximum amount of discounts that you can receive. So on a whole, the program's doing extremely well. I know Christine works with them quite often. They continue to take feedback from us, from the county, from EH&D, in order to make the document as good as it can be. And we have a very good relationship with John Saladay and his group. So we would strongly recommend moving forward with it. I don't know where you could get this broad of coverage for a county of your size out in the marketplace. There is a surcharge they started to do with the law enforcement end of it that you'll see, I think, outlined in your proposal. It's just what deputy sheriffs do and how the reinsurance works and charges like that. So we outlined it that specifically. Basically, you're charged $500 for every deputy sheriff. So that's a little different from the program, but standard across all the counties.
Mike, the nearly $200 million change in coverage, was that because we were underinsured or we were missing assets that weren't insured?
No, we weren't missing anything. Like your homeowner's policy, every year you get a 3 or 4% inflation guard. It's whoever you're with. That's usually standard in the homeowner's marketplace. For values such as ours, you really have to do an appraisal. You should really do one every 5 to 10 years. I don't think we did a formal one for probably 7-8 years. I was supposed to look at that with Bob, but CCAP does it every year. So they get true and accurate values every year, which is a great benefit to us. Mm-hmm. But our property rate, Commissioner, is so low, but they want to make sure they keep increasing the hail damage. Gave them an opportunity to go out and look at buildings again. So it's nice to see that we're getting that much more coverage with a lesser premium. So
thank you.
Very good. Thank you, Mike.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioners.
Thank you.
Human Resources, we have one item, authorize the promotion of Amanda Marshall from correctional officer to sergeant in the Berks County Jail System. Under purchasing, adopt a resolution authorizing and the award and director of contracts and procurement to execute two contracts. This is as a result of a request for a proposal. One contract for the PA Career Link Berks County operator for a 3-year term, and a second for the provider of Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act Title I Adult and Dislocated Worker Services. The first goes to Educational Data Systems, Inc., and actually both of them are going to go to the same company out of Dearborn, Michigan. But the first one is a total value of $155,548. The second, a total value, actually, this is hard to tell here. You're looking at this, Mary Jo? I realize I'm not sure.
It's a 3-year contract.
It's a 3-year. These aren't cumulative. They are each year.
I believe it.
Okay. I'll let people reference the document, and if there's any question on that, that can be clarified. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing the award and director of contracts and procurements to execute as a result of an invitation to bid a 1-year contract for light poles repair and replacement. This is a contract utilized for emergency replacement of light poles on sections of the West Shore Bypass, Penn Avenue, the Warren Street Bypass, as well as any other pole that may be identified as a property of the County of Berks. This is one of those odd areas. I didn't even know anything about this until, I'm going to say, a couple of years ago when one of the poles went over near a cemetery on 422 West Shore Bypass, and somebody contacted us and said, this is your poll. And it contacted Ryan. He said, yeah, we know all about it. It's being taken care of. I didn't know we had any of these, but we have several. That is going to Telco Inc., a local company here in Reading, and a labor per poll cost. It's again, this is written out. There's not a total cost on it. There's a pole, lamp, amp, base, and labor per pole listed in the material. Facilities, adopt a resolution authorizing execution of engineering services agreement between the County of Berks and McCormick Taylor Exton PA to provide engineering, design, construction, consultation, and construction inspection services for the removal of Berks County Bridge 40C carrying Schlegel Road over Swamp Creek in Culbertdale Township, Berks County, and not to exceed amount of $82,794. Once that's removed, Commissioner Barnhart, how many bridges, does that take us to 57?
57, correct.
Yeah. That's, I mean, we started here in 2008, I think, with 63 mm-hmm. county bridges. That's significant because that's a savings short-term, but it's a savings long-term as well. And we, I know there's several other bridges that we're looking at either to eliminate and or to rehab and turn over to a local municipality. Berksheim Nursing and Rehab, we have one item, adopt a resolution authorizing execution of a supplemental agreement to the management services agreement between the County of Berks and Complete Healthcare Resources, the management consultant for Berksheim Nursing and Rehab Facility. Is set forth in the management service agreement dated November 15th of 13. This supplemental agreement permits CHR to subcontract its duty to perform monthly exclusion check on employees of Berksheim as required by the state and federal law to provide a trust, Inc.
You missed the mental health
one. I missed the mental health one. Okay, I'm going too fast. Next, mental health and developmental disabilities, health choices. Since we have the venerable Dr. Ed here, we wouldn't want him to be at a meeting and not be able to say anything. So would you step up to the mic? And what's the district attorney laughing about? He seems to find that funny.
What was that?
The district attorney seemed to find that funny.
The venerable piece.
He finds it always funny because he really should be up here and I'm here. This is just revising some federal rules and passing it on to our subcontractor. We're also in the middle of a demonstration grant. The awardee was awarded by the Department of Human Services. It's not really through the county, but the payment is to Berks Counseling Center to integrate physical health and behavioral health. So it's rules that we must pass on to our managed care provider. They are then passed on to the provider. So we're in line with federal law.
Great. Since you're standing at the microphone, if you could touch on two things. Tomorrow morning you have your aging department legislative breakfast, and one of the big issues that you're facing as a department is the 2017 budget. If you can condense it, but share the details on the breakfast and maybe your top two concerns or requests relative to the 2017 budget.
Our annual legislative breakfast for the Area Agency on Aging is tomorrow morning, and we have several legislators and their staff coming, which is great. Two primary top concerns are the recently passed House Bill, is it 318?
I think so.
Passed by the Republican House. It's cutting block grant funding across Pennsylvania by $3.8 million, which is on top of the 10% cut that we've had. So this will affect homeless funds, mental health treatment funds. It will jeopardize our diversion program, which inevitably keeps people out of prison and has reduced the size of the prison population. Secondly, on top of that, it also reduces money to the Area Agency on Aging for the first time that I can remember to provide in-home services to keep people out of nursing homes and higher levels of care. So if the House bill is concurred by the Senate and signed to law by the governor, there's going to be a lot of hidden costs that will pass to the county through the Board of Commissioners, including increased prison costs to house people because we will not have the funds to bring them out and to divert them. And there will also be a lot more people looking for nursing home care because we will not be able to provide the in-home services there. So these are all monies that were passed directly to the state that most of them either provided or required no match by the county or roughly 3% by the county, which is a very small amount compared to other things.
And the diversion program, it's not a that's not a mandated program.
No, it's everything that they're cutting is all discretionary funding, which allows us to do other things that then in turn are really at our discretion. My discretion and your approval, of course, but
right.
They're all designed to lessen the cost, not only in county government, but to prevent people from going to higher levels of care, or in the prison case, staying in prison because we can't stop them. So for the first time in a long time, it really, it's a big concern, and should obviously be to the board.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Moving on, commissioners, we have one item. Adopt a resolution authorizing execution of a letter from the Berks County Board of Commissioners, the Berks County District Attorney, and the Council on Chemical Abuse to Pennsylvania Attorney General Josh Shapiro, urging Attorney General to pursue an investigation and, if warranted, to file civil complaint against Purdue Pharma and other big pharma companies that the county believes knew the dangers of opiate pain medications, Oxycontin, but promoted them without warning the medical community or the public as to the inherent dangers of these drugs. We have our district attorney here with us today, John Adams, and I'd ask him to step up to the microphone. Ultimately, he has authored the letter on behalf of this group and has a few comments to share.
Well, as we all know, we are in the midst of a opioid epidemic. There are many reasons that this opioid epidemic has taken place, but I think prominent and the most and the first reason that this opioid epidemic has taken place is that years ago, some of the pharmaceutical companies in our country invented and started marketing drugs like Oxycontin, which have gotten overprescribed by the medical community. There is a direct link between the opioid pills and then later on an addiction to heroin. We have my detectives interview addicts all the time, and they have reported back to me on numerous occasions that many of the heroin addicts started their addiction as a result of being overprescribed the opioid pills, the Oxycontins, the Percocets,
Vicodin,
all of those type of pills. So what we're asking in this letter, as many other jurisdictions have done, is taking some civil actions against Big Pharma to help us reimburse the costs that we are now suffering as in government, as a community, the cost of treatment, the cost of our corrections. All of these budgets have been impacted as a result of the heroin addiction. It has cost us, our community, a lot of money, a lot of resources, and it's a constant battle. So we are urging the Attorney General through this letter to take a look at this, and if warranted, file a civil action to recover those costs and to maybe reimburse government or to put those monies towards further costs of treatment and prevention and education.
Thank you. Any questions, comments?
You didn't write this letter, did you? You just edited the letter.
I edited the letter. The
letter was written by the chairman.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. But I edited the major point.
Yeah, it's a major. In fact, if he hadn't edited it, he wouldn't have signed it.
Correct. There was a major.
There was a debate on who was going to take the first crack at the letter.
Yeah.
Between you, me, and George Vogel, and so I said, "Here's my draft." And you referred to your change as a minor major correction.
Correct. That's correct. And that was done. But
and I appreciate it.
Yes. Yeah. No problem.
Very good.
Happy to help.
Okay, item two, motion authorizing the chair of the board to execute contract agreements and amendments as furnished by the contract coordinator per attached listing dated May the 9th. There are a total of 7 contracts, one jointly with Children and Youth Services and Juvenile Probation, 5 with Children and Youth Services, and 1 with Berksheim. And then a motion to ratify and confirm payments is set forth on the Comptroller's Office voucher listing. It's dated May the 9th for the week ending May the 10th of 17. And I believe we also signed, if I can back up here, 18th, 17th, 16th, the one for May the 15th for the week ending May the 16th.
Weekend.
17th. I was close. For next week, because there is not a meeting next Thursday. That's been signed, and both of those are signed with our chief clerk.
Motion to approve the agenda as presented.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Is there any discussion?
I'd like to address the letter that was previously referenced by the district attorney, if I may.
Sure.
I'm not comfortable signing this letter, and therefore I will not be doing so. I understand the motives of the letter. I think they're honorable. We have a terrible crisis with drug abuse. We've had one since I was in college, and I won't tell you when that was, but you can guess. I think that was when the real drug plague took hold of this country in earnest, and it's been a major concern of mine for many years. The opioid analgesics that are the subject of this letter are legal products approved by the FDA. Unlike tobacco, which is referenced in the letter, they have acknowledged benefits in the medical community, acknowledged benefits according to the FDA. I've read last night considerably FDA literature on this crisis and their position respecting the dangers that are inherent in the use of opioids. The FDA refers to this as a balancing act between the benefits of opioid prescriptions, which are pain abatement, most notably for people suffering from cancer and chemotherapy, which can be extremely painful, and then the risk of harm, which includes, as the letter references, addiction, dysfunction, personal and familial, and even death. Recreational use is not intended for these opioids, and the manufacturers of these substances have not promoted them for recreational use. However, like many other drugs, including drugs for attention deficit disorder and others, they found their way into the hands of children and young adults and adults who abuse them for recreational purposes. They are not directly distributed by the manufacturers to the people who abuse them. The people who permit that are sometimes also well-intentioned are physicians who overprescribe or prescribe in error opioids that shouldn't be prescribed in the first place, or that are prescribed in excessive dosages to people who should be taking a lower dose. The FDA, of course, approved these drugs. Their long-term use has revealed greater risks than perhaps were originally perceived by the manufacturer and especially the FDA. Recent years, the FDA modified its warnings in 2013. And the boxes on the warnings on the box, on the labels, have been strengthened. The dosage limitations have been emphasized by the FDA, which is engaged in physician education efforts to try to persuade physicians to prescribe them less often and in lower dosages. But about, you know, part of this entails the client, the person taking the drugs, who, or the patient, I should say, who may want them, who may have a low tolerance for pain, and may be willing to risk the inherent dangers of opioids to alleviate his pain, which perhaps he should have the good judgment to endure. In my case, and I know that in the case of, I think, Commissioner Leinbach, we've both been prescribed these opioids to deal with knee surgery. And in my case, I was given, I think, 30 OxyContin pills back in 2011. I think it was one in the morning and one at night. I took a few of them. I didn't notice that it materially impacted my pain, and I was aware that they're inherently dangerous. So I stopped taking them and just toughed it out. And ultimately, a few months ago, I found them in my cabinet and took them to the Ag Center where I got rid of them in a disposal container provided by our esteemed district attorney. And that was a good outcome. So I think there's a combination of responsibilities here. And I don't believe the primary responsibility rests with the manufacturer. And I think there's some dangerous unintended consequences by pursuing this kind of civil action against someone who manufactures something that is both beneficial and dangerous. There are numerous such things that we have in life. Automobiles and handguns come to mind. There's a great deal of misery created by both. But society has reached the conclusion, under the constitutional right to bear arms, the Second Amendment, it's important to maintain those rights in the face of the inherent dangers. Even though there is some suffering involved, there's also some benefits which society has determined outweigh the harms. In this case, the FDA has reached the conclusion that with increased awareness, education, and enforcement efforts, the benefits continue to outweigh the risk of harm. And I believe, as the district attorney stated, doctor overprescribing, doctor malpractice are a major factor in this crisis. Also, when people leave lose their prescription for these opioids, which they may have taken themselves more than as prescribed, and they could have taken five pills a day if I'd wanted to, and defied the prescription and the instructions of my doctor. I did not. But there's a personal choice involved here, too. A personal choice to endure moderate pain or to seek medications so that you have no pain, but then at the same time taking on the risk of addiction, et cetera. We live in a society, in my opinion, where, and it's a growing cultural phenomenon, where personal irresponsible behavior is excused by claims of victimization. And I think individuals have to be held accountable for their own behavior to some extent. In pursuing this letter, I think we're trying to pass the blame away from the FDA, the doctors, and their patients to the manufacturer who provides something that is very important to victims of cancer, et cetera. If we're successful in suing the manufacturers, being a student of economics, they will just have to raise the prices on these drugs to pay off the plaintiff counties and states, and then the cancer patients and the others who responsibly take these drugs will become the real victims of our efforts. They'll be paying more for something that they need, or they won't get it at all. And the FDA hasn't reached the conclusion that this should be illegal. So it's really a matter of making sure that the proper dosages are given to the proper patients. That's where the effort should be, not in suing people for or manufacturers for economic gain. And I realize this is a very difficult issue with which to deal. But the next step, in my view, is outlawing guns, outlawing or suing gun manufacturers, because, as we all know, it's a matter of time till some accident occurs with a handgun or a rifle that injures someone who shouldn't have been injured. But again, you have to weigh things in life and balance out risks versus benefits. And in this case, I'm not prepared to say that the drug companies intentionally decided to addict people for their own profit. I don't see the proof of that. And I'm not comfortable signing a letter saying that I believe that. And those are my long-winded comments. I appreciate having the opportunity to address this issue.
Thank you.
Well, since we informally discussed this last Thursday, I've been struggling with this myself. I'm going to reluctantly be a co-signer of this letter for a multitude of reasons, obviously being the co-chair of the Opioids Coalition here in Berks County. and recognizing addiction. It's, you know, for want of a better term, oftentimes the opiates are a gateway to heroin, and we need to attack this on all fronts. And certainly, if there was the opportunity to prove that Big Pharma, Purdue in particular, has created an environment where they've encouraged and created this environment, so be it. And I think the catch on the paragraph for me is pursue an investigation, and if warranted. So I'd be certainly mindful of Attorney General Josh Shapiro looking at this very, very significantly before he pursues any sort of a civil action, because I've heard all the stories about how people can tough it out and people can live through the pain, but I know from close personal experience, as someone who has suffered from chronic long-term pain and really sees the benefit of mild use of opioids occasionally to subdue those pain levels that sometimes reach that level of 0 to 10, sometimes it's a 10, and quite frankly, she was hospitalized 3 days a few weeks ago for just such an occurrence. And the only thing that has brought her some results and some relief has been some mild use of opioids, and ultimately surgery is the answer for this person I'm speaking about. But I hate to be a guy that rides the fence, but I do see the benefits properly administered, properly managed, and certainly her physician certainly manages this to an nth degree, but they are very beneficial to many people. And again, then you have people that have addictive brain chemistry, that people become addicted to a lot of different things, whether it's drugs and alcohol and so forth. But I am going to be signing this because I do believe we do need to look at this holistically, look at it from all ends. And if there is a warrant pursuit of this investigation, I'll be there supporting it. But at the same time, I certainly don't want to see it removed from the ability to relieve pain for people. But at the same time, I think it really needs to be explored and looked at and investigated. So with that, I will be signing the letter and see where it goes.
This is a very controversial issue. For myself, it's one of those areas that over the last 9+ years I probably learned more about than I ever thought I would, because of my role as a county commissioner and because of my involvement on the criminal justice side and on the drug and alcohol side of the issue. When we talk about drug addiction, it is not anything new. People talk about the 60s, but the 50s were a real rise in the use of heroin. And the first movie that ever was really made in Hollywood, at least an A-level movie, that focused on drug addiction is a Frank Sinatra movie called The Man with the Golden Arm. I encourage you to watch it sometime. It is a powerful story, it's fictional, but based on what was going on at that time. What is different about this particular issue is that there has been a dramatic increase in abuse of opioids, specifically this category, leading into heroin, not of cancer patients, but of individuals being treated for surgery, knee surgery, any number of types of surgery, or being medicated for pain. The challenge is a balance between individual responsibility. I believe in that, I think, as much as anyone, that we have to be careful that we don't become a society that wants to blame everybody for decisions that we've made. But a year and a half ago, probably a little bit less than that, a little over a year ago, we had a gentleman by the name of Chris McFadden in this room. Chris McFadden is the head of Teen Challenge. Chris shared his story, and his story was very simply, he was a quarterback for East Stroudsburg University, took a brutal hit, severely damaged his shoulder, was treated for the injury. Opioids were part of that treatment. He had no idea what was happening. He became completely addicted, kept going back for prescriptions. The prescriptions ran out. He then tried to see where he could find the prescriptions. He bought them on the black market illegally, $40 to $50 a pill, and then he found heroin could do the same thing, and he could buy a number of fixes for $10. And before he knew it, he found himself in and out of jail, and finally got the help that he needed through Teen Challenge, went through their program, and the amazing thing is today, years later, he's heading that program. I know Chris very well, and he's a man that very much believes in personal responsibility, but I believe we're talking about something different here. I'm 58. I grew up in the era where we went from tobacco being everywhere. Smoking, when I started in politics in 1980, was a norm. I, thank God, never was tempted to smoke, so I never smoked. But I went to political meetings, and there'd be a foot of blue haze on the ceiling. That was just the way it was. And people back then believed smoking was okay. And when various entities and government entities included went after big tobacco, there were many people that gave the same type of mantra, you know, the individual takes responsibility. The question here is whether or not Big Pharma, Purdue is the one that invented OxyContin, misled the medical community, misled the public regarding the dangers and the effects. FDA has approved things in the past that have ultimately been pulled from the market because they were dangerous. Silicone breast implants are an example of something that the FDA approved and then said to Dow Chemical, they're not approved anymore because people realized that there was more to it. The NFL and concussion protocol, we're in the middle of that issue right now. And there are many people that said, hey, look, nobody made this person play football. The whole issue is we're asking, and you said it well, we're asking for an investigation. If the investigation determines there was no clear understanding by Big Pharma that this was addictive, that this could cause serious problems, and they determine there's nothing here, then so be it. But I will tell you, there are a lot of counties across the United States that see the impacts, not just the dollars. And the impact of the dollars are enormous, whether we're talking about investigations, district attorneys involved in, or we're talking about our jail, people that are behind bars. There are major impacts and major costs, but there are also major impacts on human beings and lives and families. And we're simply asking, investigate. If it is determined that there is culpability, there's liability on the part of the pharma manufacturers that have produced some or all of these opioids, then we believe they should be held civilly liable. To me, that makes sense, and to me, this is a responsible thing to do at this particular point of time. I would close with this. We're not arguing that there is no value to this category of pain medication. We are concerned that the value and the dangers, more importantly, were misrepresented potentially at best, and we're asking for an investigation to address that. I don't know, John, if you want to add any comments to this discussion?
No,
sure. Okay. Any other comments? Hearing none, we have a motion on the floor. We have a clear indication from Commissioner Scott that he will be voting no on the letter. With that understanding, let's call the question. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Aye.
Aye, with the exception of 147, exception 0.17.
And those opposed?
As time, a no.
Yeah, we have that as a no. Motion carries. With that, we will turn to Dennis Adams, our county treasurer, for the treasurer's report.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We have an opening balance of $216,462,507.06, a balance to clear of $6,074,171.93, leaving us with a balance today of $210,388,335.13.
And that's probably our peak for the year, correct?
That should be pretty close to the peak.
Thank you.
Sandy Graffius, our county controller, with the controller's report.
General accounts payable $1,505,162. We had wire transfers of $2,865,318. We did not have a payroll, for a grand total of $4,370,481.86.
Very good. Our chief financial officer, Mr. Bob Patrizio, we do not have a budget operations meeting today, so no need for comment there. And Ron Seaman, anything from our chief administrative officer?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The only thing I have is to urge all registered Democrats and Republicans to come out on Tuesday and cast their vote in this primary. This is traditionally one of the least popular election cycles of the four-year term election cycles. However, it again, even though there are many offices in a local level that do not have candidates, since they are local elected offices, these are probably the ones that affect each of our lives more than any others. So therefore, it is an important election, and I'd urge people to participate.
Commissioner Barnhart.
I agree with Mr. Seaman. This election may be an off-year election, but it's one of the most critical ones. It's your school boards, it's your local elected officials, Court of Common Pleas judges, magisterial district judges. Please get out and exercise your right to vote, and don't complain if you don't vote. Again, it's becoming much more difficult for the county staff and election services to find folks who want to work during Election Day to run and manage these polls. It's over 1,200 people manning about 204 polls throughout the county, and it's literally a full-time job plus to try to find people to fill these gaps and having the proper number of people at the polls. So go out and exercise your right and say hello to your neighbors and make it a little bit of a social gathering. Maybe you'll get addicted to it and go back twice a year and eventually become a 50-year voter that we celebrate every few years. With people that have religiously voted in every general election for 50 years, and I think that's quite a tribute. So we want to see more and more people coming out and celebrating their 50 straight years of voting. So thank you. Great. That's all I have.
Thank you. Commissioner Scott.
Something I thought would be of interest down in my neck of the woods, it's still a county issue, is the an issue involving the Delaware County Solid Waste Authority and, ironically, the Boyertown area, which is proximate to the, what's it called now, Rolling Hills Landfill. Mm-hmm. They go through these various iterations of euphemisms to describe these stinking mountains of trash. But in any event, Rolling Hills, which I think has a fairly decent operating record, nevertheless, back in 2012-13, was fined by DEP because they failed to abide by DEP's instructions regarding the disposal of leachate. For those of you who are not conversant in landfill terminology, I will inform you that leachate is a liquid product of decomposition of trash and rainfall, and it percolates through trash as collected in a collection system. It is then treated. It contains various types of contaminants, and ultimately, upon treatment, it is released. You can treat it on site in a treatment facility that's rather sophisticated, or you can send it off by truck to a sewer plant or something for treatment. The latter was what Delaware County was doing for many years, longer than was authorized by DEP. DEP got wind of this. They had not followed the strict instructions of DEP with regard to disposal of their leachate, and they basically wound up in court I think, the Environmental Hearing Board, and they reached a resolution called a consent order and agreement whereby Delaware County Solid Waste Authority and Rolling Hills Landfill agreed to pay $500,000 to a Department of Environmental Protection approved environmental project. Well, I'm not exactly sure who's to blame here, and maybe no one's to blame, but the outcome isn't optimal. The $500,000 ultimately was devoted to a $200,000 grant to the Reading High School for an as yet undefined environmental project, whatever that is, and $300,000 to remediate the stream bank of the Toad Creek, a creek that traverses a floodplain in Topton Borough and Long Swamp Township. While the Toad Creek stream bank remediation is probably a worthwhile project, the people of Boyertown, who enjoy the hundreds, maybe thousands of trucks that go through the borough every week or two, probably would have enjoyed having the money directed toward them or a neighboring municipality for a project that would benefit the area impacted by the landfill's activities. Boyertown gets many, many trucks, very noisy, big trucks running through the middle of town on their way to the landfill with ash from the Delaware County incinerator. And that's all well and good. It has to go somewhere. We understand that. But under environmental regulations, when it comes to permitting landfills, the landfill applicant, when it comes time to renew their permit or for a new permit, has to demonstrate that the benefits of the facility outweigh the harms of the facility. We're hearkening back now to the previous discussion we had about opioids. There's a harms-benefit analysis, and unless the benefits, the alleged benefits, outweigh the harms of a facility, the permit doesn't go forward. In evaluating benefits of a landfill, DEP will look to various initiatives by the landfill to make the landfill less obtrusive and annoying and dangerous. So they will plant hedges. They will take, in Delaware County's case, truck routes that avoid certain areas as much as possible to minimize the truck impact. They may make donations to local civic organizations. I recall, but it tends to be the impact area that has to be addressed with mitigating benefits. In this case, the $500,000 did not go anywhere close to the impacted area, which is Boyertown. And ironically, Boyertown, as Reading High School, struggles to think of something they can spend this $200,000 on, to the extent that they're going to hire a consultant to help them come up with some idea of how to spend $200,000. Boyertown is under an order, I think, or directive from DEP to expand the spillway of the Boyertown Reservoir, which is located about 2 miles from the Rolling Hills landfill, and which is an environmental hazard to people downstream, and is a mandate from the Pennsylvania government regarding dam breasts and spillways. It only currently will accept 59% of the projected applicable rainfall quantity, so it has to be fixed, and it's a shovel-ready project. So instead of sending that $500,000 to the impacted area of Boyertown, Delaware County, DEP, have decided to spend it on an undefined project of environmental education, has little to do with public safety, at the Reading High School, and to mitigate some flooding at the Toad Creek, which is nowhere near as dangerous as the breach of a dam breast due to an inadequate spillway. So query, how did the DEP go about this? I know Mary Ann Deary, the mayor of Boyertown, spoke with me, provided all the documents she could. I did further research with our conservation district and got a copy of the contract with Reading High School. This is a less than optimal, almost foolish allocation of a significant amount of money away from the deserving area with a shovel-ready project that should have received these monies. But it happens. It happens in bureaucracy all the time. I would suggest that DEP, when these kinds of fine monies become available, should contact the local county planning commission and should send certified mail notification to every municipality in the impacted area. In this case, it would have been Colebrookdale, Earl, Boyertown, and probably Olley Townships, to see if there's something in that area that needs remediation or that would benefit the community and relieve them of the necessity to raise taxes to fix things like a dam breast. So that's just something I found of interest. I think it probably would make sense if the Board of Commissioners would communicate with DEP. The monies have not yet been expended in either the Toad Creek project or the Reading High School project, and certainly could be better applied in the case of the Boyertown Reservoir.
So, Commissioner Scott, the neighboring communities didn't even have a chance to advocate for this money?
That's my understanding, yes.
So I guess DEP had a list of potential projects and they just struck two off the list and said, well,
I think DEP
money to them.
Instructed Delaware County to look for something, and Delaware County contacted our conservation district and others, I believe. I don't know how the Reading High School got involved in a project, but I don't know, maybe there was politics behind it. I can't make that allegation because my research hasn't revealed that, and maybe we'll never know. All I do know is that this is a suboptimal waste of resources compared to what they could have been applied to.
Very good. Thank you for sharing that information with us. Several quick items. Again, you've heard it twice, but I'll reiterate, Election Day, it's important. You don't vote, don't call me to complain. Call Commissioner Barnhart. Seriously, it is frustrating that you run into people that complain and then don't vote. I remember the big Maxitawny 3 debate, the polling place, and the judge of elections went out the one day when a group of students had marched from Kutztown to the polling place and said, come in and vote. One of them had already voted absentee, the others weren't registered. And she was stunned. She shared that with me when we were up there talking, but they were, you know, campaigning for a polling place. It's important to be registered to vote. You need to go out and have your voice heard. EPA, Waters of the U.S., I know that when I testified and wrote some articles in opposition to the rule over the last couple of years, I got some criticism from some people I respect that I was on the wrong side of the issue. I even got some more when I stood in the Roosevelt Room when President Trump, through an executive order, killed the Waters of the U.S. rule. But I want to note that the EPA and the Army Corps rule. We, as a National Association of Counties, are going to be involved in that process, and hopefully that this process and ultimate rule will be a lot more common sense than the one that was put forward over the last couple of years. On Saturday, May the 20th, the Armed Forces Day Parade will be taking place over in West Reading and Wyomissing. This year, the Pennsylvania National Guard is being honored by way of this parade. Jeff Elliott, some of you know him as an attorney with Kozloff Stout. He's also a retired Pennsylvania Army National Guard. I believe he was a JAG officer at one time. He is going to be the luncheon speaker for the Armed Forces Day Parade. Encourage you to come on out. I believe that starts at 10 o'clock.
Yes, it is.
It is a great, great venue down Penn Avenue in West Reading. It turns, I think, on 3rd, goes by 3rd and Spruce, comes back by the Reading Hospital, and ends up on the western side of the Reading Hospital near the Masonic Lodge for the conclusion. But it's a great parade to come out and watch. I'll be in the parade, as I try to every year. This morning, Commissioner Barnhart, myself, and our assistants were at the Red Cross Heroes Breakfast. There were a number of people recognized. I want to recognize two of them. In both cases, they are Berks County employees. Taylor Waligorski is a 911 dispatch person. She was the 911 hero. Pretty amazing story how she was talking. A woman called in. Her husband was in a chair. He was completely unresponsive. Of course, Taylor contacted the appropriate authorities, but then she shared with this woman how to do CPR. The woman did CPR. Taylor shared how she heard the emergency medical team coming, and when they got there, her job was done. I think a month or so later, she got a card, and the woman thanked her for taking the time to help her because her husband lived 11 days. Now, we could look at that differently, but she said, those are 11 days I would have never had if you hadn't walked me through the CPR. So I want to say special thanks to Taylor. Of course, she said, that's my job. I just did my job. Well, that job meant a lot to one of our citizens. And then a law enforcement hero of the year was Deputy Sheriff Terry Ely in the Berks County Sheriff's Department. He's the individual that noticed a taxi cab moving somewhat erratically. He was about a block away. He drove up behind the cab, and they were at a light, and the cab didn't go forward when the light turned green. Well, we were able to see this morning the dash cam of what was going on inside, and a masked man was in the back seat, pulled a gun on the taxi driver, and I will tell you, it was a lifesaver for that taxi driver to see the sheriff's lights come on, the deputy come up, was able